those titles is El Shaddai, which means all sufficient. Another one is El Elyona, which means God supreme. So I'm going to try this. Y'all pray for me. El Shaddai. Oh, excuse me. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Elyona Adonai. Age to age, you're still the same by the power of your name. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Alleluia Adonai. We will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai. Through your love and through the ram, you saved the son of Abraham. Through the power of your hand, you turned this sea into dry land. To the outcast on her knees, you are the God who really sees. And by your might, you set your children free. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Elyona Adonai. Age to age, you're still the same by the power of your name. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Alleluia Adonai. We will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai. Through the years you made it clear that the time of Christ is near. Though your people failed to see what Messiah ought to be, though your word contains the plan they just could not understand, your most awesome work is done when you're born into a son. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Elyona Adonai. Age to age, you're still the same by the power of your name. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Alleluia Adonai. We will praise and lift you high, El Shaddai.
Amen. Amen. Sing with you.
Oh. shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Amen. Do you love him? I want to see him, don't you?
Hallelujah.
Good to be in the house of the Lord. You'd like to turn in your scriptures, turn back where we've been reading in Genesis 12, and we'll try to continue our thoughts on from Genesis 12. And remember now, the fellowship meeting will be on the third Saturday of September at Brother Pageant's. So remember that and be preparing to go and fellowship together and all other things. Remember the ones that are out. Remember Brother Aaron with the kidney stones. And for Brother Gary, just keep him in your prayers. The Lord would bless and guide him. Amen. We believe it. I don't know whether there's a visitor back here. I think she's been here before. But anyhow, we'll say welcome to you. So glad to have you. Just praise the Lord and fellowship with us. But I think that's basically all the announcements, because we don't have anything scheduled for a while anyway. So just remember that. All right. We'll try to pick up where we left off this morning and continue our thought on into the service. So keep that in mind that we'll background a little bit and move on, because that's what I like to do. Amen. Father, we thank you for your grace, your love, your understanding. Thank you for you. And we ask you that you just help each and every one of us to be what you want us to be, because that's our desire, Lord. And I know it's yours, is your desire to dwell within each one of us and have your way with our hearts and our lives. So come on the scene and make it work out, Lord. We love you and we thank you. Bless those that are not here because of sickness. Remember each one. And may your love be with each one of our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. So we'll go read the scriptures we read this morning from Genesis 12, and then we'll go to Genesis 15. Now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and from thy father's house unto a land that I will shew thee. I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse them that curseth thee, and in thee shall all the families of the earth be blessed. All right, we go over to 15th chapter. And that's after these things, which is a lot of different things happened, and God appearing to Abram and coming down through, and even appearing as Melchizedek and coming back through in the 14th chapter. And then he starts off, said, after these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, fear not, Abram, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. And Abram said, Lord God, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house is this Eliezer of Damascus? And Abram said, behold, to me thou hast given no seed, and lo, one born in my house is mine heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, this shall not be thine heir, but he that shall come forth out of thine own bowels shall be thine heir. And he brought him forth abroad and said, look now toward heaven and tell the stars if thou be able to number them. And he said unto him, so shall thy seed be. And he believed in the Lord, and he counted it to him for righteousness. You may be seated. The Lord add his blessing to the reading of the word. Now, to not back up too far, but try to make sure we get the connections and tie everything together, because I love to do it that way, and to see the point that we were talking this morning and been on it for a while, about how that God made an unconditional covenant with Abraham. All right, trying to get that to a point of understanding, that I remember listening to the prophet one day, and he said, I'm not speaking on this, how did he say it, to create a doctrine. He said, I'm speaking on it to straighten out the doctrines and things. Well, sometimes you have to do that, even though you can take something and look at it and say, well, this, you know, we understand unconditional covenant just means God made a covenant and it's unconditional. Well, then you get into trouble following the rest of the scriptures and tying it together and to get an understanding. All right. Now, what was we talking about this morning? God made a covenant with Adam, if you will, I will. The people back there, that covenant was made with mankind. All right. They broke it, went into sin. Okay. So he went to Noah. He made a covenant, if you will, I will. And in making that covenant with Noah, Noah come out of the ark and went right back into sin just like it was, and not following God's word to lead the people on and to multiply and replenish the word as he told him there in Genesis 9, I think it is, and not doing it in the correct form and leading, you know, over into the things with thee, then it was a conditional covenant. But then when he come to Abraham, he said, Abraham, I've already made you a father of nations. Well, now, what was it we talked about? How can you do that without being a respecter of persons? How could it be that God would do this way with one group, this way with another group, and then a different way with Abraham? How would it be that that could be correctly with the rest of the scriptures and the things to where that you would not mess up the word of God, as we would call it? All right? Well, see, that a lot of people got the great ideas, you know, I'm this, I'm that, I was born as this, you know, I was born with a seed in me, and I don't have to worry about it, I'm eternal, you know. And then you do see them going off and literally living to the point that they, you know, they don't care what God says. They think they're saved and they think everything's all right and, you know, and they're all messed up in the things of life and things and claiming to be Christians. All right. But what did we find out? Not to back up far, but what did we find out? That the reason it was conditional with Adam was the fact that he was saying, you know, you stay away from that. You stay away from that tree. Well, he didn't do it. And then Noah, it was to Noah, Noah, come out of the ark, live right, do right, I'll bless you, take care of you. All right. But remember that after they sinned was the point of the covenant part made. And then after, in the atonement that they made, or the sacrifice, is that God, you know, required, and they made a sacrifice. But with Abraham, it's God talking to Abraham about what he's going to do, and then turns around and gives him the covenant to that point there in Genesis about 15, 17, you know, he gets over and he says he made a covenant with Abraham, with Abram then, you know. But in doing that, he made it before the atonement would be accounted in the, you know, putting the atonement before the man sinned. All right? I hope you were following that point, that that was why it would be spoke of as an unconditional covenant, that God already said, Abraham, I'm going to do these things. And before you can get involved in it and get it all messed up, I want you to know that I'm going to make an atonement. All right? Then he would make the atonement, and then he would commit that to Abraham and, you know, and let him follow therein. But we know that he would not give it to Abraham on the basis of just saying, Abraham, just live like the devil and I'll save you anyway. No, that's not correct. That will not line up with any of the scriptures, let alone what you would think of it. You know, it would be on that basis, because we know that God did punish Abraham for the things that he done wrong. All right? Now, if it was so unconditional, why did he punish him? You know, so there must be something about that, that we're looking at unconditional covenant in the basis of what we want it to be. Maybe that's the point. Maybe it's what we want it to be. It's not our understanding in scriptural terminology of trying to find out. All right. But what did we come down to the basis of at the end of the message this morning, getting to the point of what comes first? All right. Now, we read there in Genesis 15, verse 6, that before God made the covenant, or, you know, established it and started doing it, there's a key part there that he had spoken to Abraham, and he led him, and as I said, verse 13, 14, and all, God has dealt with Abraham many, many times, coming down even as Melchizedek. He comes back later as Melchizedek again when he's coming down about the baby being born and all, but he meets him there and all these things. And when he does, it's a secret little key there, wasn't it? What? That Abraham believed God. And it was counted unto him for righteousness. That Abraham believed. Now we're getting away from the situation of thinking about it, that it's just, it doesn't make no difference what I do or whatever. You know. Getting down not to a conditional situation. Right. Come on, listen. It's not a conditional situation when God lays into your hands the right to do something and the ability to do it, and you follow that, that's wonderful. But if you don't follow it, what are you going to do? You know, he left it for you. Right. You got to make a choice. What would it have been with Abraham now, if I don't get into the message with none of it before I do, you know, if I miss it? Remember one thing. Abraham believed God. Abraham accepted what God said. Abraham got up, started walking, left all of his things, and went on his journey. He's a pretty good believer. And, you know, I thought that the whole Christian church world, you know, church and beings and doings of Christianity was based upon Abraham being the father of our of the faithful, that he could believe. Now, isn't that something, that God would look down at what a man believed? But it wasn't what he believed on a lot of, it was the fact that he believed God. And like I asked you back yonder 2 or 3 weeks ago, what would you do if your husband come in one day? Honey, pack up as much as you can. What you get in the car, we're leaving. Yep. Where are we going? Don't know. We're leaving out. Well, why? Because God told me. Well, did God tell you where to go? Nope. And he didn't tell Abraham where to go. Now, it is odd that Abraham, upon leaving, if you'll read the 6th chapter, as quick as he leaves, you know, from hearing God, he goes straight to Canaan. That was a very odd thing, too, wasn't it? Why didn't he just go any other way? Why? Because he would have to go to Canaan, which would be a type of the baptism of the Holy Ghost, to the believer. See? So it would come out to be the right thing that he would do it. But my whole basis this morning was ending up on the fact of what? My thought this morning was Abraham believed God. And by believing God, it was imputed unto him for righteousness. Now, I want to ask the question and tie it in with it today. I told you we're trying to get a little bit more into the understanding. But has God accepted your believing? Well, I didn't know what it was. He accepted Abraham's believing. You know. Now, has he accepted your believing? You said, well, I didn't know he had to. Well, I thought that's what it's based on. I thought it had to be based upon God accepting my believing, not that I could just believe what I wanted to. You know, well, it don't matter. God knows my heart. And like I always say, if he didn't know our heart, we'd be all right. That's the problem. We say, God knows my heart. That's where the problem's at. He does know our heart. All right? That's where our trouble comes from him knowing what we will do. You know, the old saying goes, if I was God, I'd probably done wiped the thing off and forgot the whole thing, because God knows what we're going to do. Now, that's what we want to pick up this afternoon, is why would God, taking that thought of coming to where we're at, of has he accepted your believing, but why would God accept Abraham and not accept everybody else? Now, we know he wasn't something different. He was not a super-duper person. That's quoting Brother Branham, right? He was not a great person. As a matter of fact, he was helping his dad-in-law build idols to sell to people to make their gods out of. Now, that was his part of living, you know. That was his living. He was working and doing it, all right? But yet, as God begins to deal with him, he begins to realize that, hey, there can't be all of these gods. If they are, who's the greatest? And then the story was told that, you know, he busted the idol up and left one, and his dad-in-law come back and said, what happened? He said, oh, said they had the biggest fight, all them gods, and said, this one over here won. You know, well, you know, he's beginning to see the truth. If you understand the thought, he was beginning to line up with the truth in his thinking. And as he was beginning to do those things, remember, he didn't have the new birth back there to think with. You know, he didn't have all those things. And it was a man that was believing. And you know, you said, but would God accept the believing of a man? He accepted Abraham. That's the point. Will he accept yours? He accepted Abraham. All right. Now, before we get too far out of anything, remember that it's not accepting just your idea that we're dealing with. It was not just that God accepted Abraham's idea. He had a better idea than the rest of them. So he just accepted Abraham. No, he didn't. He didn't do that. There's a lot about Abraham's doing that we've got to consider. All right? But now, keep that in your thoughts now. That God made the atonement before he made the covenant with Abraham, which was not done with Adam and Noah. I hope you'll follow that thought and read your Bible. He starts, he tells him to get this and get this, get this, get this, do these things. And then over in the 17th verse there, in the 15th chapter, he says, and God made a covenant the same day. All right? Now, so let's deal with it that way. And we know and for certainly that God has made an atonement for you and I. Before we ever even got here, he made all of those things for us. All right. Now, well, let's think about a man believing. I've always, Brother Donnie was mentioned the other day that I like to preach about the fifth sealed Jew, because that's really something to me to think about. But another thing in me is to think about believing. You know, you say, well, you come through the Baptist, y'all just said believe. I argued with them there. And like I do now, I said that word believe. I think the word believe is used in the Bible 131 times. You ought to check out a lot of what it says about believing. You ought to check it out where, like, the disciples finally with Jesus, and he looks at them, he said, do you now believe? You know, after all of this time and the signs and the wonders and the thing, do you now believe? Believing is a great thing. Because believing can lead you to faith. Doubt will not lead you to faith, but believing will lead you into faith that can become a revelation unto you. All right. But Abraham believed what God said. All right. Now, but as I was trying to illustrate a little this morning and talking about it, why did God accept Abraham? You know, don't you think there was probably good people in the world? You know. You know, even today, you know, there's better people out in the religious world system than you and I ever thought about being. Right? Why did God choose you? Well, I was just special. No, you ain't going to get nowhere. Not with me, you ain't going to get nowhere. And I know you ain't going to get nowhere with God doing that away. Because he doesn't deal with people special. Because if you look in the Bible, you'll find out the ones he used were the not too special. He chose Abraham, according to the church age book, and he lied. Yep. Right? He chose Moses, and what did he do? Yep. Got over there and doubted and smote the rocks and all kind of thing. All the people in the Bible had flaws. Right. Right. You know, I preached a message, I remember one time years ago, called The Blessings of a Blemish. And that's been 30 years ago, I guess, maybe more. And it come to a fact, see, that when they were going to make an offering for a sacrifice, you know, is they took the animals and they examined them. Right? Well, you know, that one had a blemish, they didn't use them. It lived. The others died. So I preached a little on blessings of a blemish, you know. Maybe sometimes our blemishes is what causes God to come to us, though. That was my point. All right. Now, we know for a certainty that God in his death on the cross for you and I and all, that as we were talking about in Romans, that he died unto sin once, Romans 6 and 10, and that in Hebrews 10 and 10, that Christ, talking about the body of Christ, was offered, you know, of Jesus Christ, was offered once for all. All right. So when he made the atonement, it was made for everybody. Right? But what is the reason that everybody don't receive it? They don't believe it. And some who say, oh, I believe, but then they don't believe it's for them. You ever been around people who talk about, I've just been so wrong in my life, I don't see how God could save me. Right. Well, come find out, that's the kind of people he mostly gets saved first, is the ones that were so bad. You know, but then that, you don't want to teach you that away because you'd have everybody going out and being bad trying to get saved. Well, that don't work either, so just forget all of that and get lined up correctly. All right? But why did God accept Abraham and make an unconditional covenant with him? Well, you don't consider those things and ponder in your mind and your thoughts and all of why this and why that. Well, I'm not supposed to doubt it. I'm supposed to believe. Oh, I'm glad you said that. I'm supposed to believe. We're supposed to believe the truth. Right. Believing a lie won't work. Right. Okay? So now let's start with, from connecting to this morning's message, let's try to pick up now in this believing. And by picking up this, that Abraham believed God and it was imputed unto or parted or counted unto him as righteousness. And Paul picking it up in Romans to verify the thoughts of writing back there says the same thing. You know that God must have been looking at Abraham's believing. What else could he look at? Do you have anything that you could add to the situation to think about why God would accept you? Do you have anything you could read in the book of the Bible about the great thing of Abraham? No, you start off with Abraham could believe. You mean, Brother Dale, you base everything upon just believing? That's the beginning. You can't start nowhere else. You start from the beginning of believing. If you keep on believing, after a while, you know what? God might accept your believing. Okay? So now let's read a little bit what he said, what the prophet had to say on this point. So let's see why God chose Abraham. Look at the message number one, brothers, and they're doing pretty good this morning. They didn't have to pull a little bit up, but think about it. This is taken from the message, Faith of Abraham. Brother Branham was saying what? Therefore, he by election, he chose Abraham, for he knew what Abraham would do. All right. Now, may I add this point? I keep saying it. I'm not trying to say it's on condition. But I'm saying you got to watch what you're reading to get it correctly. Because look what he said. He knew what Abraham would do. If we didn't take any more, that should be enough to answer all the questions about an unconditional covenant. That it's not just given to you, but don't make no difference. It's given to you because he knows what you will do. I thought God predestinated how? Yep. By what? Foreknowledge. No, he predestinated me. No, he didn't. It ain't even the flesh that comes predestinated eternally from God, right? It's the word or seed if you're going to deal with anything. Right. All right. But look, you remember when he called him out there and said he'd not keep the things a secret? That's over in a little bit in the parts of the to Abraham. And when he was going down to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, he said, for I know that Abraham will teach his children. I know it. God himself. I know that Abraham will send this message on down from one to the other generation. But God, foreknowing that, and knowing that Abraham would do it, then he told Abraham in the beginning that he would save him and save his seed after him and would give him the unconditional covenant that he made with Abraham, not because Abraham was good, but because God was good. Right. That should be enough to do away with all thoughts of, well, it don't make no difference what I do. I'm born with a seed in me. I'm eternal. I don't need the new birth. Well, then I guess Jesus Christ died in vain then. But he didn't die in vain because he died for me. So you can believe what you want to. Look what he says on the next one. This is a message called Faith. 1956. Then Abraham was called by election. Abraham is election, Isaac is justification, Jacob is grace, and Joseph is perfection. Now, in the beginning, when God called Abraham, he called him not because he was a good man, but because God foreknew Abraham. God knew what Abraham would do. He knowed Abraham. He said, I'll know that Abraham will raise his children to fear God, fear the Lord. God knowed him. God knows you. All right. So now what does God base his selection upon? He bases it upon his foreknowledge. Now, to go any other way with that, look what you're going to do with all of the scriptures and the teaching. Well, it's just, Brother Dale, you just don't understand. When God said it's unconditional, he just meant it and he done it. I'll agree with you there. He meant it, he done it on his end of the deal. You wouldn't listen to what I was talking about this morning.
That's right. Yep.
He made a deal with Adam. Adam didn't keep his end.
Right.
God would have kept his. He made a deal, a covenant, with Noah. God would have kept his, but Noah didn't keep his. So now, if we have an inkling within our mind that it's impossible for a human being to be able to appease an eternal God, then we need to settle down just a little bit and start thinking it over. And start considering what would be the thing that would draw the attention of God towards you. Could it be that you could believe God? Could it be that is the key to the whole thing of Abraham? That the key is that God knew what he would do? And that he believed him? Then it would not be based upon any form of something you could do or not do. So it would be unconditional. But unconditional based upon whether or not you can believe. See, this is, you don't know it, but this is destroying all of those ideas of mankind about what they thought about what made God save them or choose them or do with them. Oh, I had this seed, so he was just waiting on me to come. You can just see the preachers, you know. I've always was eternal, and really God was just waiting on me to get here. You said they don't say that. You don't listen right either. If you're listening to their thoughts, you might find it out. You might find out they're saying, boy, God was waiting on me to get here. Because if he always was eternal, the way they're thinking it, then God was waiting on you. You know why? Because you'd be God. Okie dokie. So you see where everybody's at, don't you? You see that the devil has exactly what he's always wanted. He starts off in Genesis talking about trying to help God out. He gets over a little further in the scriptures, and he's talking about coming forth and trying to be like God. And he comes forth over in the New Testament and showing himself to what? To be as God. So he's achieving the position he wants by the basis of most of the ministers that are in this message. Because they have some form of predestinations, whether it be two souls, two lords, whatever it be, some form of predestination that leads it into the point of glorifying the man instead of glorifying the God. And I'm sorry for being that away, but that at least you know where I stand then. I put all the glory and honor in him. It's not in me and you whatsoever. All right? But think about it. God knew what Abraham would do. So what brought God to Abraham? Come on. The fact that he knew what God, what Abraham would do. Is that deep, hard to understand? Or very simple to understand? Because you'll find out one of these days the Bible is so simple, that's what makes man think it's deep, is because it is so simple. Once it's revealed, it is very simple. It could not be said any other way. That's why God predestinates by what? Foreknowledge. Not by the fact that he predetermines things to be, but he's got the foreknowledge of knowing what it will be. All right? Now, but think about it. So if it's based upon the fact that God knew what Abraham would do, then it would be the same basis of you and I. It would be upon the same basis. So the only way you could see the predestination of God is to know that God foreknew, and then may I quote the prophet? He said he knew you would want to be saved. Therefore, he had it here for you when you got here. Now, I never did find where he said you come here with it in you. And I simply asked the two soul people a simple question years ago, and it was a simple question to me. I asked them, you believe this seed, God put a seed in you, and you believe you'd come into the world, and you believe you heard the word. I said, which one's of earth? Is it the birth of what you hear after you get here, or what you had before you got here? Man said, I can't. I knew he couldn't answer it, because there is no answer. See, because if he answered it one way, I'd have him trapped. If he answered the other way, I'd have him trapped. So I'm just waiting on him to answer, but he wouldn't answer. All right? But you see, church, to me it's so simple until it passes over our thinking. You know, what about the fact that what if Abraham had not accepted what God said? What if Abraham had not believed what God said? What if he had demanded some sign and wonder, some great thing to happen for him to be able to believe? I've over and over said it unto you, you don't find anything in Abraham where there was great signs and wonders in his first beginning. Then after he believes God and starts on his journey with God, sure, you got a plenty of times of God appearing to Abraham. But not in the beginning. It was just simply God speaking to him, and he believed it. Can you do that? Well, if Brother so-and-so would preach it, I'd believe it. Okay. Or I believe it because so-and-so said it. What have we got? What does that do with the Word of God? All right. What about these statements that Brother Branham would make? Go ahead with number three, the way of a true prophet. And he's talking about how God has already done it. And he gets down to the bottom and watch what he says. He's already forgive your sins. He's already healed every sick person. He's already appropriated that blood at the Calvary. The price is already paid. It's all paid. But the only thing you have to do is to accept it, believe it, and accept it. Watch. And you cannot accept it until first you believe it. Well, I believe it. Now, that's cheap words.
Amen.
Right. In the Bible, the word believe is a very special word. It does not mean a head knowledge of every incident. Now, there's a lot of it there it does, but the basics of the word believe is based upon a sure foundation. Believing is. Believing is a great ability for you to be able to believe. All right. How much more sure in God But did you hear what he said? The only thing you have to do is accept it. Believe it and accept it. Now, God knew what Abraham was going to do. So all he had to do was cross his path. Right? Deal with him a little bit in a supernatural point. And Abraham says, Lord, I believe you. At least we could say, help thou my unbelief. Get it away from me. But what about it? You've heard the prophet talk many times of how that if God was standing on the platform with a suit of clothes on, he said he could not heal you. He said, because you're already healed. So you could stand there, cry and pray, come down and heal me, Lord. That's what most people do about healing. They cry and pray and say, Lord, heal me. Why don't you start thanking him for healing you? You know, it might work. And it sure ain't going to work for you begging him. Now, you won't brother around over that. You don't beg God. You accept what he says. Right. And then you make the right, what is confession? To say the same thing God says. Right. God says you're healed. Yeah. All you got to do is accept it. And you can't accept it until you believe it. So believe it, accept it, start saying it. Well, here's where we go. But Brother Dale, I don't have the healing in my body. So if I went out telling everybody I was healed, I'd be lying. Oh, you poor human being. Don't worry about lying. You was born one. One more lie ain't going to make no worse or hell for anybody. Right? But you know what it is? You're lying if you don't say you're healed. Right. Now, which one do you want to be the worst on? I'm going to stay on that side. Because if I'm going to put it on the basis that God said it, and I'm going to say it. And then if he's anybody lying, it'd have to be him. Right? If I say what he says. Well, there's one thing about it. You ain't going to make him a liar. All right? But to believe it and say it. I thought that's what we believed in the scripture. I thought that's the way salvation come according to the book of Romans. To believe in your heart. What? And confess with your mouth. I thought that's what we believed salvation the way it came. I thought we believed that was the way it came to everybody that was in the Bible. So it has to come the same way to you and I. See? Believe it. Say it. So he said, but the only thing you have to do is accept it. Amen. Has God accepted your believing? If it's true believing, he'll accept it. If it's according to what he says, he will accept it. Right? But if it's not, he won't accept it anyway because it's not according to him. All right? Watch what he gets on to this one on just once more. He says, if he can just get you to believe, you're not saved tonight. You were saved. You were saved 1,900 years ago. No, see, then you really wasn't because you were saved before the foundation of the world. That was when the debt was paid. But do you believe it? See, now here comes, we're revelated. We are so educated in the Word. We're talking about accepting God. See, then what does everybody want to do? Oh, but Brother Dale, I know where the quote is. That you don't accept God. God accepts you. That's really an offline point to start with, but we'll use it. Go ahead to number five and let's read it. It's taken from the Future Home, paragraph 275. Just like all the curse of sin is gone when the Holy Ghost accepts you. See, you don't accept it. It accepts you, see? Because it's God's attribute. And if it's the Holy Ghost, means God's Spirit, and it's the attribute, then the thought of God has accepted you because that you were ordained for that purpose. Now, see, you say, but that corrects all of that accepting. Does that do away with all the quotes that Brother Branham, you could find them where he's talking about you must accept it, you must confess it, you must believe it, you must say it? Does it do away with all of the Bible where we were just quoting? Does that one thought that you're bringing, but remember, it's saying there, when the Holy Ghost accepts you. Why does the Holy Ghost accept you? Why did God accept Abraham? All right. Why did he accept Abraham? Because Abraham believed. Why does God accept you? Because you're a certain special person, because you're great. No, he accepts you because you believe. Right? It's because you believe. All right? Now watch him as he gets to the message, perseverance. And he says it like this. He says, and no matter what your trouble is, you must accept it. And before you can accept it, you've got to believe it. Because faith is based on, or healing is based on faith, and faith is based on the Word. All right? So why can't we do, as I said a moment ago, why don't we try it to start saying, by His stripes I'm healed. And no matter whether you get better or worse, you keep the same statement. But our problem is we say I'm healed. And maybe things will go away. But then they'll start coming back. Well, I must not have got it. Must not have got it. Right then is when you need to hold on more than anything up on the basis of your faith and say, thank God for it. How did the prophet describe it? He said, the sicker you get, he said, that's the greater sign that you're healed. Confess it, say it, and believe it. Why can't we believe it? Why can't we believe the Word of God? Oh, but Brother Dale, if I just had thus saith the Lord, if I just had thus saith the Lord, if I just had thus saith the Lord, I'd believe it. Right, here it is. Right here is the Word of God. That is, thus saith the Lord. Yeah, but you don't understand what I mean. I mean something personal to me. See, what you're wanting is God to come down out of the sky and say, you're healed. But what are you going to do? Do you stand up and say, I'm healed, and you get worse? See? What do we talk about an unconditional covenant? Well, it just means no conditions. I haven't put a condition on whatsoever. I put it on the basis of what God says in His Word. I haven't put a condition upon your salvation. I put it upon what He says in the Word. He said, if you believe it and confess it. Now, that's truly believe. Now, I know the rest of the story, okay? I can quote. Oh, but Brother Dale, I can't believe till the Holy Ghost comes. That's a quote. But you don't have no believing till the Holy Ghost comes. Then where is your mental believing that would be able to become a spiritual revelation? Is that what he says? Blasphemous name, stature of perfect man. I believe it's blasphemous name. When your mental faith becomes a spiritual revelation, well, what if you don't say it before then? What if Abraham, when God spoke to him and said, praise the Lord, I want y'all to know the Lord spoke to me. Glory, look at me. I'm great something. Go, God of heaven, come down and spoke to me. Say, what did he say? He told me to get up and leave. But I'm not going to do that. Because I've already got his word. Because he said that he'd make me a great nation. He'd make me a great people. Would have God been obligated to have to make him that away? Would he? Would he be obligated to make him that away and him sit at home and not get up and do what God told him to do?
Yeah, but I don't understand it, Brother Dale. Because you're always making conditions. You're saying Abraham had to do something. He didn't have to do nothing. He just had to do what God told him.
Right.
And God told us, just leave you home.
Right.
He said, okay. Come on, honey. We're leaving. You know? There's no condition. He's just obeying God. God is simply saying, Abraham, now using it paraphrase, okay. Abraham, tomorrow about noon, I'm leaving this Ur of Chaldees. Are you going?
Right?
Because I believe if God was telling Abraham to leave there, that meant God was going to leave the Ur of Chaldees, don't you? So he would have been saying, okay, you got the choice, Abraham. Stay here. I'm leaving. Sometimes we must step out upon what we believe. Right? They didn't run me out of the Baptist church. They wanted me to stay. But when I found out the truth, you know the reason I left the Baptist church? Because I found out the truth about it, that God wasn't there.
Right.
Now, you can go with all of your playing, all you want to in your mind, but get away from that now. You can say the anointing's down there and this is down there. Just get away from that. Don't do it with me. It don't work. He had already left. I found out he wasn't there. I wanted to be where he is at. Now, if you didn't, there's something wrong with you. Because if you didn't, you left for some other reason. Come on, you know what I'm talking about. The anointing is down there. The anointing is over here. The anointing is with them. Yeah, the presence of God for a lot of things is with them. But what left? You want to quote it ahead of me or you want to leave it? Let me say it. The word of God is what had left. Come on, if you're going to follow the words, you're going to walk alone. It ain't no crowded way when you walk with the word. You're going to walk alone. That's the way I love it, you know. Not that I don't want nobody with me. It's just that I love the word because I know that he walks with me. Remember what your prophet said? A pardon is not a pardon unless it be accepted as a pardon. Now, if you don't want that direct quote and think it's not that way, just go to the message, pardon, preached in 63. A pardon is not a pardon unless it be accepted as a pardon. Salvation is not salvation unless it's accepted as salvation. See, then you accept, then you confess. All right? Now watch.
unconditional covenant is not to say, he will save me even though I don't want to be saved. It's not that way. Because he's overriding your free moral agency. But the unconditional covenant is to believe that God has already done it. And all we must do is accept what he said. He says, I'm saved. Why can't I say I'm saved? He says, I'm healed. Why can't I say I'm healed? He says, I'm blessed. Why can't I say I'm blessed? Right? What about it, church? Yeah. If he died for the sins of the whole world, then the whole world could be saved if they would believe. All right? You accept that? If they would believe. All right? Will you accept the fact that he knows then that people won't believe? Then who made the choice? God or you and I? See, church, whether you realize it or not, or whether you've never thought about it or not, but you know there come a day in your life somewhere that you had to say, wait just a minute. If I'm going to walk with the Lord, I got to get up and go. I can't stay where I'm at because I done found out too much. Right? I got to get up and walk out. No matter what, even if I just walk out, I got to get up and walk out. Sister Gail, I used to get tickled at her. She used to sing with that Christian choir thing. And then when they got to singing, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, oh, I laughed. Because she got worse, she couldn't sing that, and then she had to lip it another way. You know. You see, we all had to make a choice. Amen. Choose you, is that what the Bible said? Whom you will serve. Right? Is that the way it is in the Scripture? If God be God, then I'll serve him. If not, then forget it. What about your believing? Has God accepted your believing? Now, let me put it this way, will you, for a second. See, then God can't accept your believing if your believing is a Trinitarian thought. Now, may I express it that way? He can't accept your believing if your believing is a Trinitarian thought. Now, what do you mean? Anything contrary to the truth of God is a Trinitarian thought, okay? Comes from some other source outside of the real true God. So then how can you say that you believe the Bible when your thoughts is contrary to the Bible? How could we have any right whatsoever to ask God to do anything for us if we don't do what he says? Right? And that's not trying to work your salvation into something. That's just simply being right and doing what you're supposed to. He doesn't require for us to do great things. But he requires us to believe. Right. And then automatically with believing will become things in our lives. Right? It'll become a part of us. Right? And see, that's what I've always tried to emphasize about Abraham. God chose Abraham because Abraham could believe. Now, how much more simple is the gospel? He accepts your believing. He accepts you and your believing. So he had it for you, waiting on you to get here. Why is it that you can believe? Now, think about it a minute with me, okay? As I said, that word believe is a whole lot stronger word than just, well, I believe. Yeah, I believe. It goes into a straight, a more deeper thought.
why did God accept you? Or what are you doing here in the message or the hour? Anybody on the internet or whatever you're doing and listening, think about that. Do you in Lula, Georgia, think about that? Why did you? Sister Gail, don't mind me telling this on her. She come in fighting. She'll tell you in a hurry. Most everybody, when I heard the message, I just received the message. I just straightened up, made everything right. Now, most of you better not say that around me. I might remind you of some times that we had problems believing. But see, Sister Gail, tell it like it is. I come in fighting. Why? Because she wasn't going to accept something she couldn't see. Is there any problem with that? Well, when I first heard it, I believed it. I just believed it, and I first heard it. Be careful. You better be able to back up what you're saying there. I believed the water baptism, but it took me about 6 months to get baptized. What about you? Okay. So think about it. God has kept his end of the bargain. He's made a covenant with mankind. He came himself to die in the place to make sure that covenant was true. We'll get to it, the Lord willing, Wednesday on how that he swore by two immutable things that he would keep his word. What are those two things? Well, see, Abraham, simply when God spoke to him, he believed it. And God says, that's what I want, is for somebody to believe me. And as I've said over and over and over, there's not a bunch of signs and wonders in Genesis 12. Let's start speaking of this Abram. It's just that he heard God and he believed it. How many times have you heard God? Oh, but I've never heard God. I believe God come down and said, Abram, now I'll talk to you. Was it that way? Or was it a simple thought within the man's mind? I ain't going to argue with you either way. I'm just making a point. How about the rest of the world? Did he not offer salvation to anyone else besides Abraham, as we talked? Were they not good people in that day? As I said this morning, how many virgins in the world in the days of the conception of Christ that was actually saying, well, you know what, maybe one of my children, maybe I'll be it. Because they're looking forward to it. But he only accepted one. Now, what did Brother Branham say about Mary that you and I need to think about? What was the point that he made? Now, I'll try to think of the message in a minute. Somebody may think of it. Give it to me. Spoken words written on the seat. Got it. Brother Branham said Mary had a virgin mind as well as a virgin womb. Now, what if she hadn't had the virgin womb? What good is the mind? But she had both of them. She had a virgin mind to believe God's word. She had a virgin womb that she had kept and preserved within herself. But do we have a virgin mind upon God's word? Or has it been infiltrated by mankind so much until it's not virgin anymore? That's what I said. The truth is so hard to preach because not just to you doing it, but I know people and other thinking, and you say something, I know where the prophet said it. I know where he said something different than that. Like I said a while ago, you must accept Jesus Christ. Not whether I accept him or not, whether he accepts me. With that kind of attitude, don't worry about it. He ain't going to accept you. Is that enough? Then people get upset at me and they say, Brother Dale, you're saying I'm lost. No. I'm saying the way you're acting, you're lost. Because it'd be about me too. See, because we're going to prove what we are. Well, I just can't believe that. I was on the phone with a man one time, and I quoted something Brother Brown said. He said, I just can't believe he said it. I said, hold on till I get my computer correct up, and we'll get it, because I can't remember it right offhand. Yeah. You see, church, Mary, had that virgin mind. She had sat and listened. You've heard Brother Branham explain how that Joseph and Mary sat around in the cool of the day looking at the new home that Joseph was making over their farm after the morning service. And they would sit there and eat a meal, and they would talk about what the priest had to say. And one day they were talking about, said, you know, he was speaking this morning of Isaiah, there shall where a virgin shall conceive, and said, you know, someday that's going to take place. And maybe her sitting there, a little quiver came on her heart. Just a little something. That maybe she was just thinking, well, you know, somebody will do that one day. But when the angel of the Lord come to her, he didn't have to explain the Bible to her. Right? He didn't spend 14 hours sitting in the shade explaining the Word of God. He just said, Mary, I've come from the presence of the Lord to deliver unto you this message. You and Joseph was talking about it back at home today or yesterday or something. But said, I've come to make it alive to you. What did she say? Virgin mind, see. What did she say? Be it unto me according to thy word. Of course, sure, she was a human being. How can this be when I know no man? He said, the Holy Ghost would overshadow you. And that thing that is created in you will be the Most High God. She said, be it unto me. How about you? Do you realize, now come on, musician, do you realize the day you walked out of that denominational church, the day you saw the truth and began to walk, no matter if we just took a few steps, but still, do you realize that you were saying, be it unto me, Lord, according to thy word. There's going to be a bride in the last days, right? Be a word-born bride. Be it unto me, according to thy word. See? So simple until it can be happening, but yet we're looking for it because we don't see it. Why don't you just believe it? Why don't you just believe that you're the bride of Christ? Or you, like I told you about one brother said, I believe I'm born again, but I don't know where I'm bride or not. Now, what kind of an understanding is that? If you're born again, you're bride. But see, because of all of our
super religious knowledge. We reject the simplicity of God's word. Well, I just don't see it. I just don't see it. I don't see God among us like he was on the shores of Galilee. I don't see God among us like he was in Brother Branham. That will never be seen by one person anymore. You can get that out of your mind. Nobody's trying to. But I believe that that same ministry of the Lord Jesus, the same ministry of William Branham, is in the bride around the world.
I believe that.
That I believe. If not, what's your point? Me? That as much that is what I do believe. Because I believe what the Bible says. All things are possible to God. Is that what the Bible says? It says that, yeah, because it's in the terminologies, but a little different. But what does it say? All things are possible to them that believe. Well, why don't we start saying it where he can make it manifest? Right? Well, don't want to say it because dang, I don't believe it's here. Well, then you don't need to say it. Just shut up. You don't even try to shut up. But don't get in the way of somebody else that's doing it. May I quote Brother Branham? He said, if I can't make it manifest, don't let me stand in the way of somebody that can. Is that his words? Well, why can't we believe it that way? What we got, brother? Let's stand.
We have come into this house and gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house and gathered in his name.
Do you have a need? I believe that same God. If I'm going to believe Hebrews 13:8, I got to believe that he's the same today. I can't believe he changed and believe Hebrews 13:8, because that was what was wrong with Eve. Eve doubted Hebrews 13:8. Has God accepted your believing? I know you've heard them, and I know I've heard preachers say, I'm not going to preach because I don't know about that. Well, maybe they're honest. But we've had 40-something years to pray and study one message. I was talking with Brother Nestor and them the other night about this. We've had 40-something years since the going away of the prophet. All right. Well, yet people today can tell you more about some movie star, some worldly event of a ball team, or and then turn around, and you know it's true. Turn around, and somebody's talking about the Word of God. That's a smart aleck. He's intellectual. I think we ought to be intellectual, if nothing else. 40-something years to study one message. But how many of you have even heard 10 messages in your 40 years? How many of you have heard every message that you could possibly know of? Or at least tried? But we're in the message. Need you say something to the people about the message? Where'd he say that at? You know what? If you'd have spent your time doing that instead of all the other things, you would know whether it's true or not. Right? Brother Dale, I don't believe in writing in the Bible. You're not doing that. I just simply got a record before the prophet explained that scripture as to what it means and what it's saying.
Is that wrong? At least I dread it. You know why that I don't want a new Bible? It would take me 3 months without doing anything to underline and write down the things in a new Bible that I have in this one. But you know, a lot of people don't even know what it says. They don't know what the prophet has taught. How do you know whether the person preaching to you is preaching error or not if you don't know the truth? Then whose job is it to know the truth? I thought the Bible said, what? Ye shall know the truth. But how many of you have read the Bible? How many of you have read the prophet's message? You ain't never heard me tell a story that I don't believe it. I've told you many times about how we used to go to Jeffersonville, and they'd have 500 books printed and 1,000 people would be there. And I knew if you wasn't up at the front, you wasn't going to get a book. And they'd start passing those books out, and I would just go right down through there like I was looking for a seat. And I'd walk up looking, and like I was looking for a seat, the man would pick up the books, and I'd just get a handful, and I'd go walking back. Everybody that went with us got a copy. You'd say, that's being nasty. I'm a shyster. I'm a Jacob. But I got the book. I got the book. What about you? Called a 2-year theologian after coming in the message. Why? Because I read. I wanted to know what the prophet said. I want to know what he says about Genesis 12. I want to know what he says about all of these scriptures. I want to know what he says. Holy Spirit. But would God accept your believing? Now you know better than, you know what I'm fixing to say is right. You can't take a Trinitarian doctrine and go to Israel, right? You go over there and try to explain to them the great mystery of the Trinity. Brother Branham said, they'll tell you in a hurry where that come from. But you just think about how dangerous it would have been for Brother Branham to went over there. And what he was speaking from God's word. And God coming down to vindicate that. So he couldn't do it. He had to leave and come back home, right? Why? Wrong time. Do you understand what I mean? We claim to be in the message, but it's the message in us. And I don't mean just quotes. That's got to be the start. But I mean revealed. You know, I should be able to just stand here and say, Brother Brown said so and so. And everybody says, amen. But still, you're having to read what he said. Because a lot of people don't know. What is the two things of the immutable point that he... There's two things there, Paul said, that shows that God can't lie. What are those two things? And I'm reading simple Bible. But do we know what those two things are? See, you think I'm hateful and arrogant. We've had 40-something years to study this message. That's what God has given it to us, to study the message. He's given us all the things. He's given us the computers. He's given us all the technology to be able to search the message instantly now. But do we use it? Father, just be with us as we go home, Lord. Forgive us of being ourselves. But you know within my heart of what I want and the desire that I have is for your people, Lord, to come to know you in a saving knowledge of grace, and that you could accept us. And you could say, well done, thy good and faithful servant. Enter into the joys of the Lord that was prepared for thee before the foundation of the world. What a wonderful statement that would be. Lord, just help us. Go with everybody. Take care of us on the highways. Give us of your love and your grace. We love you. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, you're dismissed. We do.